Hey guys, welcome back to the ULOL Campus Series 2017 presented by the Collegiate Star League. I'm Joshua Piscator Lee here back with Bill Jump Carter for our second game between Indiana University Kokomo and Goshen College. IUK up 1-0 so far. Let's see if Goshen can bounce back.
And we're back and we're hoping something different maybe happens. That was my tune. That was my tune.
I think you have a great voice.
Thanks. I'm going to quit casting, move to California, and just
all right, we got to talk, homie.
Hold up.
We're back. And it looks like something's changed in amidst between these two teams because that's going to be a Renekton ban.
Oh, dude. Can I take a guess as to why they ban Renekton?
Please give me your expert opinion.
I'm the play-by-play, but I'm going to step into these color shoes for a little. We got some dope kicks, man. They're nice. So they banned Renekton because IUK completely bodied Goshen College in the top lane. That top lane snowball got the rest of the map going, and then the game was over by 10 minutes, even though technically the game went 36.
Yes.
Did I hit the nail on the head?
You did indeed, but look at the way that you actually see Kokomo responding to this, because the gangplank, believe it or not, was actually a vital piece of the defense that Goshen did provide in a lot of that game, because he was able to win his lane. He was able to use a lot of that wave clear, as well as that global ultimate and the damage that it provided due to how far away ahead he was, to actually stall that a little bit out. So a very fantastic flex ban here coming out of this Kokomo team.
Caitlin and Renekton, both picks that IUK had first time around, getting taken away. The bans on the other side, still pretty similar. We saw Vi, Leona, and Victor get taken away that first match. But it looks like Maokai actually gonna get locked in first. We talk a lot about how in the Collegiate Star League and the ULOL Campus Series, a lot of teams, they're not gonna adhere to the pro meta as strictly as, well, you know, the pros do. But Maokai is definitely one of those picks that's super strong nowadays.
Yeah, without a doubt. The lack of resources that he needs to be relevant and the power that his teleports provide are extremely strong. However, that second point is something that both of the teams struggled with in the entirety of the last match. Teleports. Being able to show cross-map pressure is a huge piece that separates the good teams from the great teams. And so if one-time dealer wants to stay relative, he's going to have to use those teleports in some sort of proactive manner.
I don't think we've seen any of the teams really use a whole lot. Oh, boy. Vayne spotting. Let's go, baby.
Oh, let me pull up my scoreboard.
First rotation pick, Vayne.
Oh, did I throw away my score sheet? I think I still have it here from the last time I watched you play Vayne. Some here.
Are you serious? Are you going to start making fun of my AD carry?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Bruh. Nah. My Vayne is bad and bougie, dude.
It is indeed, but the bad.
Reckon on kids like I'm Uzi.
Goodness, the Kha'Zix. The Kha'Zix, meanwhile, switching back to relevant conversation. Yep.
That Kha'Zix takeaway, really important because we're talking up Arsenic on IUK side the entire time. It was that top lane gank that managed to get number one feeder snowballing on that Renekton, and the fact that he had like almost 90% kill participation by the end of the game, Kha'Zix was something that Arsenic absolutely bodied on. But it looks like James is actually going to take that away from him.
And not only does he take him away, but it's going to have to force versatility from Arsenic. Yes, these are only best of threes. Yes, essentially, they lack a lot of the adaptability that something that a best of five brings you. But it doesn't mean that adapting isn't an extremely important part. And oh, by God, by golly, is that going to be a Skarner in the jungle? I believe it is, as Arsenic goes from carry jungler to complete lockup pick potential here with that Skarner pickup.
All right. All we need is Zed in the mid lane, and then we have this full AD comp going. Oh, man. If they locked in that Ziggs first, then it would have been a flex pick, you know?
Would have been spicy. would have been spicy indeed. But alas, it is still going to be the Ziggs in the mid lane. Doesn't falter at all from the power and the strength that he does provide. He is, however, going against a Syndra, something that we glossed over in the second rotation for the blue side. Syndra,
whoa,
another very strong champion, and another champion that has actually been rising up. You're seeing it pop up in a lot of the AD carries. You look at NA solo queue as they're preparing for LCS. You've seen Laude and Doublelift both pick up a little bit of extra Kalista. Granted, Doublelift isn't playing in LCS this split, but it doesn't mean he still doesn't like to keep up with the meta. Venison guy definitely picking up somebody that can go strong. A complete diversion from the backline, very safe pick that he had in game one.
Kalista coming back into the meta ever since. You can now stack Rend stacks when Rend is off cooldown, so makes you a lot scarier when that's on cooldown. A lot of times people like to wait for you to actually use Rend before, you know, they were going on the Kalista, but now that's a threat that always stands as long as the Kalista is alive. It's like Goshen, though, they have their last pick available to them. Which lane are they? Oh, they actually have their support pick. Ooh. Trundle's gonna go top lane. Tahm Kench, one of the safest, well, in terms of, you know, keeping your AD carry safe, one of the best options out there coming into the meta more and more as of recent. Kalista Soraka versus Vayne Tahm Kench.
I love
hashtag
this.
Farm.
I love this a lot. Granted, it does make the lane phase a little dull as both teams have complete and utter protection. But what the Tahm Kench does for me is it's a direct counter to Ruassa and his Syndra. Ruassa proved that he could stand his own against an Ahri that even had a kill advantage at one point in the game, as well as that very early blue buff. But insert Tahm Kench, insert the tongue-licking man himself, tongue-licking gentleman.
There has to be a... No. That has to be... There has to be a better combination of words.
No, of course not. It's the tongue-licking gentleman, man. Come on. The tongue-licking gentleman. How many licks does it take to get to the center of a Ziggs bomb?
You just need to stop right there.
But all in all, it is to counteract that Syndra, and that's going to be extremely mm-hmm. important. So now you,
Ozzyk too, if you think about it, yeah.
You have Lost Person being able to be that stopping point, that unovercomable obstacle for Syndra, and Ross is going to have to be extremely, extremely careful when he decides to ult specific individuals, because if Tahm Kench is around either Ziggs or Vayne, it's going to be a no-go. Chomp right up, complete and safe carry in the back line.
It's simple. You kill the fish man, and then you get to kill the rest of the carries. We'll see if IUK can continue their momentum and finish out this series 2-0, or if Goshen can dig deep and find a victory, forcing us to go to a Game 3. Ladies and gentlemen, you are watching the ULOL Campus Series 2017 presented by the Collegiate Star League. We're going to get into our spectator delay, but before we get onto the Rift, why don't we check out a quick word from some of our sponsors.
Ben, Sam, and Ken are on separate journeys to defeat the menacing Vile Dragon. But let's just say luck isn't on their side. If only there was a way for them to find each other and band together. Well, that's why there's Band. It's a mobile app that allows people to come together using common interests. We'll be right back.
go.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the ULOL Campus Series 2017. Today we're featuring a match between Indiana University Kokomo and Goshen College. Let me Goshen College on the blue side this time with One Time Dealer in the top lane, James in jungle, Ruasa in the mid lane, Venison Guy on AD carry, and Josh Masa 99 on that support Soraka.
And for Indiana University Kokomo, taking up the red this time, it's going to be number one feeder, our MVP from last game, taking up the top. Arsenic in the jungle, Mastin in the mid lane with first core, and Lost Person rounding out at the AD carry and support. It is
now, I want to point this out, Bill.
Uh-oh.
Looks like IUK is staging themselves to take a massive gold lead in the first minute and a half of the game.
They did it!
They're going to light it up. Oh, they did it! 30 gold on the board! Sorry.
That was excited. That was an obscene amount of excitement.
My neighbors are going to start knocking on my door. Where's the gold at?
Yo, I want the gold. Where's that gold at, though?
I'm ordering you a pizza.
Oh, wouldn't be the first time, and it sure as heck isn't going to be the last. As we do see, both of these teams finally decide to go off into the lane. Same as the last time, starting off onto that blue buff. Keeping things simple, keeping things eloquent is the word I'm looking for. The victorious Malachi makes his debut here in Collegiate Star League. Nice and beautiful, sash and everything, as he heads right back on up to the top.
See if that Malachi does end up victorious by the end of the game, because had a bit of a rough time at the top lane. I feel like that's pretty fair to say. Number one feeder was not the number one feeder in the game. I feel like One Time Dealer actually took on that name. A lot of that was due to Arsenic's jungle pressure. I know Skarner does have that CC available, but a Maokai is very hard to kill even early on, so see exactly how that top lane goes this time around.
Because both members of these top laners do have a fairly decent amount of sustain just in the passives that they have. You've got the lifesteal coming out of number one feeder. You've got a little bit of extra oomph coming out of this Maokai as well. So I don't think we're going to see as much attention. It's going to be them essentially farming themselves up and hopefully making more TP plays than they did in the last game. Mind you, that only is going to take one teleport, but all the same, a teleport indeed.
You'd be technically correct, and that's the best kind of correct, if I've learned correctly in my life.
It is. Technically correct is much
James,
better.
Though.
And subjectively
gonna take
correct.
A page out of Arsenic's books on that cause. It's gonna jump right up to the top lane to number one feeder. Does have the flash available. Gonna flash too late and gonna die anyway. First blood goes to James.
Caster curse is real. James comes right up to the top lane. He's the one that took away the Kha'Zix and was the passive jungler in the last game. Arsenic taking over the aggressor, but instead, pre-3 minutes, he's gonna come right back up. Get himself a kill. He took this kill in the top lane, not One Time Dealer, mind you, and it forces the teleport out of number one feeder so he can get back to lane.
See, we saw a teleport.
We did it!
They were listening. They're like, oh, you want a TP? I'll just die so I TP back to lane.
They didn't say where it needed to be. You just said it needed to happen.
We found the D button. Oh, the F button. You have your teleports on the wrong buttons, guys. Come on, get your stuff straight. Teleport, everything but flash is on D. Josh Masa, however, gonna feel the wrath of the inside of Tom Kench's belly.
Oh,
as that's
a rock.
Oh, TP play! I haven't seen this before in this series yet. One Time Dealer gonna jump in just to get the members of IUK off of his bot lane. But now that gets number one feeder a little bit of time to push in that top side.
Yeah, little bit of a late decision whether or not he wanted to cancel. Probably should have canceled that and just walked up to the top lane, because now he's going to have to go all the way back and all the way back up to the top lane. Pings for a little bit of help, but number one feeder decides to slow push that wave. It doesn't look like One Time Dealer's actually going to lose that much XP from it. So even though he has to teleport down, and you've got about a 25-second advantage number one feeder has on that teleport now, he's still going to be able to soak up the experience and try to get some of that CS back.
Yeah, it comes down to how well he can farm under tower, but I feel like Maokai is a pretty decently easy job of doing it. I believe he has the highest base AD in the entire game.
Yes, he does. And on top of that, once you get a couple levels in your saplings as well, then you're able actually to get a full clear, as we see a little bit of a scuffle here. Bot lane coming up.
It's actually going to knock them away, though. Nobody wanting to commit to that fight quite just yet. Number one feeder spent a lot of mana to try and shove in that way. Probably going to take a back right here. Go back earlier on to grab some boots along with the corrupting potion.
Boots and pots and pots and boots.
Boots,
I don't know why.
Pots.
Boots and pots and pots and boots. It had a little bit of a ring to it.
It's like the noob's way of beatboxing when you just say boots and cats.
Yeah.
Lost person coming in with a tongue lash. One, two. Not quite getting the third stack off. Gonna pop that thick skin rather soon. Gonna absorb the Ren. Good timing on that right there.
It's gonna be another slow start there. You see Lost Person wanting to have a little bit more of aggression. Arsenic is there. Only level 4. Gonna get spotted out by the ward, though. So there shouldn't be any opportunities for him. But look at what we see coming out of here. Ruasa is level 6. Whoa. But it looks like he gets thrown right into a troll.
Juked his own teammate. The pillar came up a little bit too far away. Mastin now out of mana, not quite able to deliver the bombs anymore. Number one feeder did come in for a little bit of assistant, getting a little bit of pressure off. Ross are going to have to back, going for the first buy. And assume going to go for that Morella Nomicon first. Lost Chapter is picked up in addition to an Amp Tome. A little bit more AP to boot.
Slowed the game a little bit down ever since that first kill that James was able to pick up in the top side of the map. But now you're getting closer to those level 6 spikes. Urasa actually the first one in the game to hit that level 6. This is where you're going to start seeing the blue side be just as proactive as the blue side from last game. You've got a lot of power and a lot of strength coming from that ultimate on the Syndra. James is going to be able to have that invisibility as well as that evolved skill once he hits himself a level 6 as well. So a little bit of a setup as we see now, level 4, but it doesn't mean he doesn't want to come in.
For a little bit overextended. Lost Person, gonna keep his AD carry safe right there. I have Venison Guy a little bit of trouble. Venison Guy a little bit too deep, taking a tower shot for no reason. Vayne peeling for even less of a reason, so I guess they got a little bit something out of it.
Hey, they got the trade. I'll gladly trade a tower shot for a heal on my enemy AD carry any day of the week, especially with this how weak and squishy that Vayne is early, as we do see a little bit of a power arsenic. He does have the advantage here.
Don't want to fight within Skarner's zone. He's going to run right into the Ziggs right there. The empowered auto attack, not quite enough. Ruasa unleashing the power onto first core, and that Vayne going to drop.
Arsenic
now blowing Ruasa the other
feels play up, man.
The other side of the map, though. Teammates slowly in tow, providing a little bit of backup. Arsenic now going very low. The Skarner should be falling relatively soon. The last auto attack ensures the kill. The rest of the members of Goshen College now gonna back out, maybe pick up some fruit on the way back home. This looks like at the end of the day, a little bit of blood on both sides.
A little bit of blood indeed, but the advantage most certainly is gonna go over into Ross's favor. We know what he can do once he gets kills and gold into his pockets, and that's exactly what's happening. Not only does he pick himself up a kill, but he also gets himself an assist to boot. Doesn't have that ultimate available, but Bastion!
Doing his best Syndra cosplay as he one-shots Ruasa. That's why I don't overstay. Take your wins, cash in at the bank, get out of there. That overstay cost Ruasa his life, putting on a little bit of extra gold into Mastin's pocket.
Bit off a little bit more than he could chew, and he couldn't quite balance the Syndra balls correctly as he ends up going down to Mastin. And so now, everything that we just talked about, all of the lead that we said, all right, maybe we can do this, started to pay off, isn't going to end up doing so, as now you're dead even in the mid lane. Mastin actually with a little bit of an advantage, as he's going to be going for a split build. Is that a cloth armor I see? So did League of Legends change in the last, you know, month of me, you know, not casting it? Because as far as I remember, I'm not 100% sure if armor necessarily blocks the damage that Ruasa is going to be able to provide.
I mean, the right clicks will definitely be mitigated a little bit by the armor. The split buy is something that I guess is okay, because eventually I think Ziggs is going to want to have a Zhonya's in there somewhere, especially since you have a Kalista and a Kha'Zix on the other team. Buying it now, though, especially when you just fed Syndra a kill, probably not the best idea. It's not completely useless, though. Oh boy, can't even talk. I was going to say it definitely doesn't help you there. She just clicks R. Going to pop the barrier, though.
Is able to pop the barrier, pops the flash as well, so that's going to be the flash down. And just like we imagine, it's going to be a little bit of aggression once that level 6 hits, as we see one-time dealer coming after this arsenic.
So Vengeful Maelstrom up to absorb a lot of the damage, and now it's a 2-for-1.
Uh-oh, here comes Ruasa.
Long term going to pierce him. Maokai staying alive for quite some time. The Soraka heal coming in just in time. Ruasa also here for assistance. The big bomb comes in. Ruasa, however, only one to find a kill in that fight thus far. Number one feeder. Chugging a potion, running away as this jungler does fall. So it looks like Goshen College done 4-for-2 so far.
Yeah, but look at how much more roaming we're seeing. Yes, we did see a whole heck of a lot of fights in game one, but there wasn't as much roam presence from either one of these teams. Now, You take a look at what Ruasa has done. You take a look at what he has been able to provide to his team. Both of his kills have not been in the lane. They've been in, or his own lane, rather. We had one kill in the bot lane onto the first core. You had another one go into the top lane onto, I believe it was number one feeder. So now you're in such a difficult position because one of the members that you don't want to scale if you're IUK right now is the enemy mid laner in that center. The one-shot potential, the amount of just raw damage output that she has when she can get those items rolling, certainly something to look out for, and that's exactly what Gosh is wanting, and that's exactly what Gosh is getting.
Ten
their tag is
50.
Gosh, by the way. I don't know if you know this, but on the overlay, they're
I was just
Gosh.
Ignoring it for a while. I'm like, oh, I think he said the team name wrong, but I'm just going to ignore it because that's what you're supposed to do when you're casting TP coming in. No, that's a Tom Kench Abyssal Voyage coming in instead. Venison guy going to toss the Soraka away, sacrifice his life so his only begotten daughter in the form of Soraka can survive. Kha'Zix, however, can get chased out by multiple red members. Kyoshin not going to want to overextend there. Don't want to give up any more of the lead that you have. One-time dealer, number one feeder, giving each other lots of hugs in the top lane.
Fight, fight, top fight. They never stop going. You do have a little bit of a ward accumulation being focused down by IUK now. That's something that they did very well in game one. Prioritize those entry-exit wards to try to help get themselves a little bit more vision and knowledge of the enemy team. Because the dragon priority that they have placed in the first game is certainly looking like it's starting to transition to the next one. But I do stand corrected, as now it looks like they want to try to get something down. Ruas is causing trouble, so the goon squad is coming.
Gonna clear out a lot of the vision in the bot side of Goshen College's jungle. We still have a couple of wards around the dragon. Remember in the previous game we saw IUK take 5 drakes, I believe? Didn't even manage to get to an elder drake. The threat of that alone, I feel like, definitely made Goshen College crumble a little bit, but we're 12 minutes in, no dragons taken as of quite just yet, and it looks like one-time dealer paying the mid lane, looking to try and take down Mastin. Lost person choosing a pretty poor place to back. It looks like they want to commit to this. They don't know Skarner's there though. That zone is not somewhere you want to fight. Lost person looking to commit to Venison guy.
Teleport.
Here comes Kha'Zix around the outside. The teleport does come in. Where's the pillar? There it is, blocking off Venison guy. Here comes the Skarner ult, and they're all focusing down the Kalista, and she blows up with a kill secure from Mastin. The rest of the members of GC now running away. One-time dealer arriving at a party that was completely on fire. One-time dealer gonna get stunned up again. Big shields coming through. The vengeful maelstrom is up. I'm not sure how much damage this Maokai can tank, but it looks to be a whole hell of a lot. First core going in with the ultimate. Couple of stacks with the Silverbolts. He's gonna turn his attention to the Syndra, taking her down, and somehow the tree makes it out alive. But his teammates, two of them drop.
When one member is there to support and the rest can follow, that is when your team finds a success story. And that's exactly what happened here. Beautiful coordination in that team fight, focusing down Venison guy immediately. And then if you saw, a lot of that turned out on its head because Mastion had a beautiful rotation around the banana brush to force the members to back off. This led in turn to themselves getting themselves another kill. They're able to get themselves a dragon. So two deaths, a dragon, all of the advantages that Goshen tried to pull themselves out at the beginning of this game just got turned right on its head, and it looks like the barn burner has started here for both of these teams.
IUK now ever so slightly ahead in terms of gold, 19.9 to 19.5. Not a whole lot of gold, but considering that they were down for the majority of the game, effectively a gold swing of about 1,500. Definitely on the right track for them as they're looking to secure that 2-0 to bring their record from 1-1 to 2-1. Remember, there's a lot of money on the line in the ULOL Campus Series. All scholarship money, sure, but we know how expensive college is. You want to win here. First four getting a nice 1-2-3 stack off. Bane slowly coming online. All those daggers in place. Unleash power onto Mastin. Hit R to win in this game, it seems like. And now Venison guy looking for the Vayne on the opposite side. The Ren not quite enough to kill, and it looks like they're trying to turn the fight around. IUK, the Condemn against the wall. Venison guy getting chunked. Jukes out the Starfall, and Josh now alone. Gonna have to try and get out. Ruasa gonna come for backup. The Syndra making sure that his support stays alive.
Cheeky.
IUK picking up even more gold.
Cheeky coordination is we're gonna have to pause on some analysis. It looks like James wants to show some action back up in the top lane.
He's fighting, number one feeder. Probably gonna get away under tower. One-time dealer burning the ult right there, but it looks like Arsenic on that Skarner now coming through that tri-brush to try and provide a little bit of assistance. Just gonna find a control ward for his efforts. Gonna back up out of there, provide a little vision security. Bit of a reset.
So you take a look now what both of these teams are wanting to accomplish and who they're wanting to make those accomplishments happen and essentially become the success for them. When you look at the protection and the power behind the IUK team composition, it all revolves around their carries. They have scaling, they have power, they have damage. Mastion and First Core, 4-1 and 0, 1-1-2 respectively. The longer this game goes, the more of a priority that they're going to have to be for their team's success. And by getting this early kills and these early golds, definitely going to be able to help them as they can start transitioning into this mid game.
And thinking about the mid and late game later on, both of these teams have some very scary scaling threats, but I feel like I have to give the edge to IUK here, considering that Trundle is like damn near impossible to kill later on in the game. Vayne, it's damn near impossible not to kill somebody start right clicking. Syndra, he just clicked R on somebody, somehow doesn't manage to get the kill there. First Core just trying to kite out with the invisibility, gonna get exhausted, but doing a great job of staying on the back line. Lost versus staying in the fray for as long as he can. Big crits coming through onto Josh, not quite able to get the three stack off, so the Soraka does stay alive. Three members down bot though, Mastin throwing down the ult to try and clear out that mid wave as Ruasa is applying a whole bunch of pressure on that Ziggs. IUK though, gonna survive bot lane. Now Skarner's here for the help.
Skarner's Terrara, been doing a fairly successful job. Not as aggressive, Arsenic, as we did see him in the last game, but he's still been able to have, what, he's got three assists now, 50% kill participation, trying to stay relevant. It looks as if he wants to try to continue to farm up and have a little bit more damage with the Frozen Gauntlet, as well as the sticking potential that that's going to provide to him. But you have to take a look at what Goshen is trying to do to counteract this. You've got three kills in the pocket to Ruasa. Just the amount of pure pressure that he's providing is absolutely fantastic, but that over amount of pressure that Venison Guy is being able to provide is just not doing anything. It's Osnick.
You went full Boston.
I went full, but my Bostonian came out. Osnick is running away from the jungle.
Okay, now he sided my people for a second. Oh boy, we got kind of racist there. But you are from Boston, though, so I guess it doesn't.
I do. I live in the area, so
close
I
enough.
Can. Yeah, I can.
You
I
know guess, how they sound.
Yeah, I can do my people.
Get into the skid here. Minute 50 on the clock. Second Drake slowly coming up. We saw the last game. IUK did pick up 5 of them. It looks like this is gonna be another Cloud Drake. Gotta move fast. Hashtag Sanic.
Uh-oh.
Oh! Mastin, Zhonya. See, that's where the Zhonya comes into play. Now you just wait a little bit longer before you completely die. Ruasa
late
taking
teleport.
Down Mastin.
Late teleport comes in. But uh-oh, Dealer's teleporting down as well.
Well, I guess Dealer's teleport was a lot more useful considering that it did get the members of IUK to back off. Number one feeder though, a little bit late pulling the trigger. Both TPs now off cool, now on cooldown though. Number one feeder is gonna come up a little bit quicker.
500 gold lead in the advantage of Goshen right now. You take a look at where that lead is being accumulated. You've essentially got even CSs across the board, but where the real big discrepancy is coming in is in the slight advantages in the concentrated gold that they have. And that's where you're going to start to see that concentration of gold really be a big part. However, just as I do say that, it does look like it's going to be a tower going down in the bot side. First Core picks up the first turret. 18, almost 19 minutes into the game, our first turret went down. First turret went down at roughly, I would say, 13:45 in game one. So a much slower, much more cautious game from both of these teams, despite the 12 kills that we've had in this first 20 minutes.
Definitely a lot more roaming, but it does seem like none of these players are too keen on leaving the lane too early, as it looks like one-time dealer gonna have to leave eventually. He's gonna pick up that standing gold in the form of the first tier tower right there as Ruasa just continuing to walk ahead and Mastin having to pay that Syndra some respect. 4-2-1, 129 CS. Scorpion King, not quite gonna get caught out. Mastin coming in for the assistance. Uh-oh, Abyssal Voyage! It's a Tom Kench party! Venison guy getting out pretty safely. Soraka gonna flash out. Ruasa now trying to kite away, looking for the turnaround. Lost person popping the shield to stay alive. As it looks like the Maokai now roaming down topside. Mastin could have gone for a twisted advance, but not quite wanting to commit fully there. Dragon is live. Whichever team wins this team fight around here, likely to pick up the Drake.
The Drake is all important. It does look like if we take a look at which Drake this actually is, that Cloud Drake indeed going to provide a little bit of extra roaming and a little bit of extra movement, which is certainly going to be helpful for the Goshen squad. And as we see it, it doesn't look like there's going to be any kind of contest. All the wards are there. There isn't a teleport on number one Peter. It looks like IUK is just going to give this one up. Tied 1-1 in dragons, a Cloud Drake apiece.
That gold lead. Or that gold counts, rather. Staying pretty damn even.
30.3k to 30.5k. First game kind of turned into a blowout ever since number one feeder got snowballing on that Renekton, but this game a lot more even all the way to the 20-minute mark. Baron is live. We'll see which team picks that up. Looks like the first thing they want to do is pick up this tower. A lot more standing gold to take advantage of. We're going to bring that tower count to 2-1 in favor of Goshen College. But it looks like in the mid lane, IUK pushing that tier one down. So just as I say that, one team gains a lead, the other team gonna neutralize. Oh boy, Arsenic going deep.
Oh, come here, Raka.
Who wants a unicorn for dinner? She's gonna pop the ultimate to try and save herself, but it's not even gonna matter. Now you have a dead Soraka and no ultimate.
Now, not only is this a dead support down, but look at what they're doing in a very smart maneuver. You have a huge wave being pushed up onto the top side and no top laner to spot. So they're going to rotate themselves right around and see if they can potentially pick something up here. Oh, they're going to wait in the push. Oh, this is going to be glorious.
And this is going to be a 7-minute team fight as he tries to kill this Maokai. Going to go 3-for-1. Looks like they're going to focus down the tower first. Maokai slowly realizing what's about to happen to him, but help is on the way. Pillar up, make sure Kha'Zix can't quite jump in, and it looks like IUK not going to be greedy. They're going to pick up the tier 1. Get the hell out of there.
Something that IUK did exceptionally well in game 1 was taking their victories and running away. Right here, prime example. They get the kill. Maybe we could potentially pick up another, but no. We're not going to risk it. We're not going to worry about it. We're already sitting very even in this game, so let's take what we have and let's leave.
It's like hitting and running at a poker game. You ever have that guy at your poker nights?
No, I usually just lose all my money in the first 20 minutes. So
we did play poker that one time
we
at the
did,
Liquid House.
And
remember?
I lost it in the first 20 minutes. So right.
Didn't your check say like Lee, didn't was there an itemized Lee, thing where they
Liquid 112, if you're out there, thank you so much for taking my money because you took all my money that night.
This is a true story. Jump borrowed money from the owner of Team Liquid to play poker against him, and he lost it all
it
while
terrible.
Working for Team Liquid.
It was not my proudest moment.
Too. Syndra still strong.
First
just
core
a couple
goes
of
down.
Years up, unleash power onto the unsuspecting AD carry. First core down for 30 seconds and change. Gives an opportunity for Goshen College to apply the pressure in that mid lane. It's the last lane with the tier 1 still standing. They want to grab that gold because right now the gold is somehow virtually dead even still.
It is indeed. As a 7-7, literally everything is almost identical here. As Soraka, Unicorn round 2, now we're prancing in the jungle and it looks like the Scorpion is here to sting and to kill.
Popped ult again. Now, I'm not the color caster or the analyst here, Bill, but I feel like if you're going to die 100% of the time there, regardless of you ulting or not, you probably shouldn't burn it in the first place.
Yeah, you take a look at the cooldown. That's 104 seconds. That's over
just take
a minute.
The L.
Over a minute and a half that you're not going to have that available. You're up in 15 seconds. That's going to leave you over, like I said, a minute and a half of zero utility from your ult. So if you guys are looking to fight, you're not going to have that available. And when you're in a situation like you have here from Goshen, you have to find a way to be able to survive. And that Soraka is the only lifeline that you have to do so.
0-2-2 so far. Not quite the hottest game for Josh Massa 99. Struggled a little bit in the previous one as well, playing that Thresh support. So building out a Frost Queen's Claim. I haven't seen that item in quite some time. Usually people just go for the full upgrade. Very slot efficient, in addition to provides decent value as well. Oh, James though, gonna find some value by killing the Ziggs. Massa just gonna flash out. They do know the tower is under siege now, and the rest of IUK gonna start rotating over slowly.
Slow rotation. They're not gonna have any time to really get any kind of turrets of the sort. A very successful maneuver that you see from Kokomo right now is they are allowing the farm coming up from first core. Granted, he's only down about 20 CS. That's not a huge discrepancy considering the scaling that both of the members have, but the more farm that you can get, the closer that you can have to those hard power spikes, the better. And with the Infinity Edge being so close into the pockets of first core, securing that wave management, as well as picking up that IE, really big step, fantastic job here by IUK.
First Core does have the money for it, just needs to actually back and pick it up. All the components there. 1.3k in the bank for him. It's always fun when you have a Vayne roll up to you and three-shot you. I'm sure that's what all the tanks are feeling on the other side. It takes a little bit more skill than Syndra. Syndra, you just have to hit Q, then R. Vayne, you have to click a few more times.
25 and a half minutes. Much has slowed down, apart from the picks that Joshmas has gotten done onto himself. You've got Dragon spawning in just 40 seconds. We can take a look and see that it is indeed another Cloud. So three Cloud rolls in a row. Not necessarily the best on the RNG market, but at the same time, being able to stack them and be able to give that multiplicative, I guess, power does help themselves out a little bit. Number one feeder's going to clear out the Baron pit. We did see the Baron being taken before the 27-minute mark last time, so it wouldn't be surprised if that's something that pops up here in game two.
You ever get a triple Cloud Drake in a game?
You're
just playing solo queue. It's hilarious how fast you move around.
They actually did something of a test of, and it wasn't obviously intentional by any means. We might have to pause here.
Hit R! No R necessary! No. Tell strong Syndra sometimes. 2.5 items here. James going in a little bit too late, but it looks like they're looking for the counter engage. Gonna find the knockup onto the tankiest person on the opposite team, but Ruasa with a big flank, taking down First Core. What good is an IE if you can't even use it? Ruasa going in a little bit too deep, biting off more than he can probably chew. Soraka ultimate comes through, but it's not going to be enough to save him, as at the end of the day, it's going to be a 2-for-1 in favor of Goshen College.
It is. You've got the ultimate coming out from the Tom Kent to try to stop something. Here comes a teleport from number one feeder as well. Uh-oh, this could be bad.
Outside.
One big pillar could stop them, but one-time dealer is around the outside trying to cut their approach off. Number one feeder going in for the find. It's a tank battle so far. Venison guy getting free damage off. The Bork is on, and he's chasing forward with the Ren Stacks. The Ren Stacks come out to try and slow them down. The re-engage is here. Venison guy still getting free spears off. Lost Person goes over the side with Trundle in his stomach. And James gonna try to go assassin versus two tanks. Realizing that, don't have the damage. Here comes Ziggs, but into three members. I don't think he wants to commit to that. Arsenic on that Skarner also electing to back up that mid lane. Tower still somehow standing 27 and a half minutes into the game.
So you trade a teleport and a flash for the flash and the exhaust. While you provide a lot of pressure with that teleport, having that exhaust down against such high energy, high damage targets on the IUK squad, that is going to be an advantage for them at the end of this fight. Looking forward, you have waves being pushed in Goshen's favor on both sides. And so while we saw a lot of action and a lot of opportunity for even more, that's going to get nipped right in the bud as both the side waves here for IUK need to get reset and pushed back in their favor.
Number one feeder going to go to the top side, pick up that gold. First Core going to go bot side, pick up that gold. Vayne getting stronger and stronger as time goes on, looking for a second Zeal item, as it looks like. Oh, bye-bye, Ruasa. Nice to know you.
And this is just a pure example of what Arsenic was able to do in the last game, but now he's doing it with a completely different utility. First, I'm going to find you, I'm going to kill you. Now, I'm just going to find you, I'm going to put you in my little pocket, and then I'm going to let myself and my team kill you. As the amount of pick potential that he's created, 5, 2, and 3, locking down Josh Massa, locking down Ruasa, and other various members of Goshen, this could be a big opportunity for them if they can get the sideways movement. Because if you look, they got the kill, but what are they actually doing with it?
First Core has been split pushing for 29 minutes and 8 seconds, which is the entire length of the game. Good for them, though, to make sure they get that gold in their AD carry's pocket, especially when you're probably the highest single target damage dealer in the game. Did I say that right?
You did. That was a tongue twister, but congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. True, right? Vayne, probably the best single target sustained damage dealer?
I wouldn't necessarily say sustained. Because she doesn't necessarily have as much lifesteal as right now. But as far as constant DPS goes, for sure, without a doubt. And the raw output that she has, especially considering the fact that you do have a mega tank in one-time dealer, with that sustain from Josh Massas amongst the front, you're going to have a lot of DPS output and a lot of consistent DPS output from First Core for any sort of fights to go that way.
Not quite prioritizing a Last Whisper So right now, Venison Guy actually picking that up third. But it looks like First Core actually electing to go either Rapid Fire Cannon or Static right here. Gonna go for that squishy single target burst damage on that Vayne. Could be good if you can lock down that Syndra or that Kalista, but otherwise.
A lot of confidence as well, if you really want to think about it, because when you are in a situation that has such high burst, you look at James and the power that he has on the Kha'Zix, you look at Ruasa and that Syndra, even the Kalista to a certain extent with the amount of attack speed that Venison Guy has, there isn't any kind of protection. You don't have a Bloodthirster, you don't have a QSS, even a Guardian Angel is something that we've seen some Vaynes go as a third item, but instead, it's prioritizing that attack speed, like what you had mentioned, it's all about getting that damage off, and so that's a lot of confidence in First Core's own ability, as well as confidence in that protection from the team that he hopes to accumulate and provide.
Step one, don't get hit by Syndra. Step two, don't get hit by Kha'Zix. Two very difficult steps, but if First Core can pull off those first two steps, I feel like the rest of the team fight kind of plays out by itself.
Oh, no.
Arsenic, however, looking for Ruasa. That's one person that you definitely want to take down. One stack, two stack, three. Scatter the weak keeps them away. Mastin arriving a little bit too late to join in on the fray. Ruasa just going to get healed up because Soraka is total BS and all of your mistakes don't matter.
However,
the members of IUK away.
So you did get out alive, but look at what you spot. Any kind of utility that you lose is obviously a huge piece that is going to be lacking in the next team fight. Yes, you do have double utility on the side of Ruasa. The ghost is down, not a big deal, but the heal is down on the Venison Guy. And so if Josh Massa goes down, pops the ultimate there, so that's going to be one less part of sustain. Venison Guy, without that heal available, might get a little scary as the siege is pushing down the mid lane, but it doesn't look like it any success.
Arsenic has that impale coming out in just a few seconds as well. Josh Massa not having that wish. Gonna make the next fight much more difficult for Goshen College. The next fight might be coming up in the next 20 seconds as we have the first Infernal Drake of the game spawning at 32 minutes. Two Cloud Drakes for IUK, one for Goshen. Ruasa gonna run right into the Scorpion, Lost Person arriving on the backside for a little bit of assistance. One-time dealer and number one feeder in the top lane both with teleports up so they can join in any time that they so desire. Soraka pretty far away though. Ruasa still around that bot lane, so it looks like IUK may take this as a cue to start the Drake.
You do see both teleports available, but uh-oh.
Big damage on the Venison Guy, that's big.
It is a
but
big...
But Soraka's on the team, so it doesn't matter.
Dragon gets started, but Ruasa gets caught!
Ruasa's in the middle, that's not the place you need to be! Somehow finding a kill on the exit of that First Core going down at the hands of Ruasa. Now James blasting himself around the wall, they're gonna turn the focus to the Kha'Zix before turning back to the Drake. Now Venison Guy jumping into the fight, no flash available, every single member of IUK with Kalista in their eyes! And Arsenic taking down the second kill of his fight. Four members still up for IUK. They're rotating mid lane, looking for the Soraka. Gonna flash forward, the smite down, the E comes out, but the fracture's not enough to finish him off. The bouncing bomb, however, will finish off the Soraka. One-time dealer, very, very tanky. Not quite sure if they're gonna be able to catch him out. Sun comes through. We could be here for a while. I'm just gonna sit here and wait. He's gonna die. There we go, ace for IUK. Big gold lead, three Drakes to their name. Scattered respawns on the other team. They may go for Baron here.
Baron, without a doubt. When you are Goshen and your entire existence relies on the success that Ruasa has found in the mid lane, you can't allow yourself to get caught out. Ruasa, 8-4-1 at the time, ends up picking up that fifth death, and you can't have that. Too much pick potential, too much power on the side of the IUK squad. It led to a disaster. It led to a dragon, a tower, Whoa. A Baron. Mind you, as Ruasa gets caught again.
They could go for the re-engage though. James going in deep, finding a kill onto Arsenic, and now Venison Guy. Big crit for the win as First Core trying to kite his way out of there. Good juking by the AD carry, a double kill for the Vayne as three more members of Goshen fall. This game started off pretty even, got to the middle points pretty even, but now that we're getting to the mid-late stages of the game, IUK really starting to shine.
It's all about that teamwork, but more importantly, it's about the capitalization of your enemy's mistakes. It's not always about being better than the rest, it's always about being better than your enemy at a certain point in time. Capitalizing on Ruasa's misplays and making sure to optimize their objective control, something they did so flawlessly, being up 7-0 towers at one point or another, is definitely proving them them worthy. Up almost 7,500 gold. We're starting to see the reason why IUK might come out of this on top.
Number one feeder gonna chomp on a Gromp. And a Blue Ward.
A little bit of extra gold. Last time you chomped on a Gromp, Piscator.
I usually lose games when I play jungle, so a long time.
All right, well. You
no, I did leash as Twitch AD carry, and I'm pretty sure I've stolen the Gromp that way before, so maybe that time.
You haven't gone like, you know, people go frog gigging. You haven't gone like Gromp gigging or something like that. Had a couple Gromp.
Wait. Hold up. What is frog gigging?
So down in the south, they have this thing where we get a poker and we poke frogs and then we eat it.
Are you kidding me?
It's a delicacy, man.
All right, that's a delicacy? That's some savagery! Dude! He's like, what did I just, like, what is this can of worms?
We're just gonna gloss over this.
We're just gonna ignore that.
And move forward. 36 minutes into the game, Baron certainly in the favor of IUK. The wave pushing down in the bot
side.
Are
you gonna eat that too, dude? Kind of looks like a frog, man.
Oh, man, it's Scorpion. That's the next one on the menu.
You drooling when you look at Tom Kench, too? He's kind of froggy looking.
He's a catfish, man. Come on.
He's a catfish. He's just catfishing. He's actually a frog. Oh. Arsenic, however, gonna tank up the first initiation. Big bomb onto the backline. Gonna force the members of Goshen to back away before the fight even really started. Baron buff on the bottom wave. Gonna apply a lot of pressure there in addition to number one feeder on the top lane. Gonna probably get that tier two unless somebody rotates over with haste. It looks like one-time dealer gonna be assigned those duties. But Arsenic also gonna provide some backup. Pressure across the map for IUK. 3 dragons to 1. Up about 10,000 in gold thus far. Things looking pretty good for a 2-0.
And this is where you start to see the advanced level of understanding. Uh-oh.
We start to see another fight. Big crits coming out of the vein. That's why you build double zeal just like that. Soraka falls. No more heals for the team. Luasa just looking for a way into the fight. Unleashed power goes out. But just like that, Tom Kent swallows him up and negates the ult completely. Scatter the weak onto the tank line. Not going to do a whole lot of damage. It looks like IUK not quite wanting to pull the trigger just yet. One-time dealer going to take that as his cue. Jump in. Number one feeder trying to get away with his life. Venison guy just looking for the lifesteal on the minion wave. Mastin throws down the big bomb. Not quite able to finish anybody off. But multiple blinking members of Goshen College going to force them to back away.
And all in the meanwhile, you've got Arsenic pushing up in that top lane. That's going to be a downed turret, and it doesn't look like there's anything they can do to stop it. 6 towers to 2. We're almost at the 38-minute mark, and the gold lead is slowly but surely increasing in Kokomo's favor.
Oh.
All right, that works.
I'm like, oh, I wonder if they're going to... Oh, yeah, they have Zig to TC. No Lich Bane either. I want to point that out.
The power of the Ziggs, when they did do the change where his Satchel Charge actually can essentially execute a turret past a certain level percentage of that tower, definitely going to be working in their favor. Mastion, 6-4-4. Not the most illustrious of stat lines, but certainly doing his job at Ziggs in the mid lane.
I also want to point out that Bang is the best Ziggs player in Professional League of Legends right now.
He is indeed.
He's the... That's a weird time in the league, dude.
The LCK, it is the best and the worst. Amongst all of the hatred that popped up across all forms of social media when Ziggs AD Carry actually started to become a thing, Freak, believe it or not, tweeted out that he was ecstatic that Ziggs was popping up in the bot lane because it's the first sense of variety outside of the MF support that you saw Samsung pull out in the 2016 world. But the fact that there's this versatility and kind of this just new innovation that you're seeing from League of Legends definitely keeps things fresh for the players that have been playing a very long time and have experienced the drudgery of many situations and many metas in League of Legends.
Yeah, not gonna lie, I wasn't a whole big fan of the whole Jhin Ashe meta for the longest time. It's like, oh, occasionally we're gonna see Sivir. Not seeing that variety. Makes me really happy.
Elder Drake is available. It's not the stack up of Elder Drakes that they had in game one, but it's still all the same is going to give them a lot of extra power. 3 Drakes still gives you the multiplicative burn, but now you've just got a little bit of waiting. You've got the teleport available from Numbfeeder, but uh-oh, is it going to be a cheeky play? It looks like it is, as it looks like Arsenic and the rest of the team wants to come in.
Oh, Ruasa, how many times are you going to get caught out right before a fight? That's not something that happened just once. That happened so many times. Now, first core goes in with a big crit. Takes down Venison Guy.
That one-time dealer, all he can do is run away. Josh Massa picking the wrong way to run. Gonna get focused down by the members of IUK. Arsenic gonna claim credit for that. Three members of Goshen College are now down for the count. James and one-time dealer, the only two available on the team to try and push the members of IUK away. Two inhibitors going down, all five members of IPA alive and healthy. This could be game.
Could be indeed. Multiple members down, three of them, 20-second death timers as well. You've got a little bit of a wave, no Baron left available, but a lot of damage coming out from this Vayne and Ziggs.
This could be the last fight right here. James going deep, gonna have to run away through the pillar. One stinky pillar, if I do say so myself. One-time dealer gonna get pinned against the wall. Vayne gonna do just Vayne things, chip away even without a last whisper on that AD carry that Maokai's gonna melt. Ladies and gentlemen, for our 7 p.m. matchup in the ULL Campus Series 2017, it looks like IUK gonna mow through the members of Goshen College, secure themselves a 2-0, and improve their record to 2-1.
2-1, taking over the fourth seed, or the fourth place position in the North 9 division for the ULL Campus Series 2017. And it was, by and large, an entirely collaborative effort. But when you take a look back and you say, all right, how is this power able to, you know, surface through on both of these games? How are both of these teams able to really come out on top? And for me, it comes down to the top laner. So for the Band Gaming MVP, I personally am going to have to go to number one feeder. Finished 2-1-7 in this last game, finished with zero deaths in game one, and two different roles that he was supposed to play, but all the while, it was pressure across the map. Regardless of the teleports, it was all about the pressure that he put on, the lane advantage that he got, and just the amount of obnoxious presence that he created at every stage of the game.
Probably going to have to agree with you there, Bill. Number one feeder also gets my vote for the Band Gaming MVP of the series. I mean, it goes to say how one advantage in one single lane can spill over so hard across the rest of Summoner's Rift. If you want to learn how to take advantage of a lane lead, watch this series. I think it was a pretty good example of what can happen if you get snowballing early on a snowbally champion, and then you can lead your team to victory. But I believe that is going to do it for the ULL Campus Series broadcast tonight on Collegiate Star League. Thank you so much to everybody who tuned in. For all of you who are looking for even more Collegiate action, remember, tomorrow we have Dota 2 and StarCraft 2 on C Star League and C Star League 2 on Twitch. Friday's ULL games, we're going to see the University of Connecticut take on Dartmouth. And we're also going to see Texas Tech take on Houston. A lot of fun, exciting games. Thank you so much on behalf of myself, Bill Jump Carter, my co-caster, in addition to the entire CSL staff. Also want to give one last shout out to all of our sponsors. It's going to be Band Gaming, Twitch, and Asus. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for tuning in for the final time tonight. I'm Joshua Piscator-Lee here alongside Bill Jump Carter. We will see you guys next time.